International Schools, the Secretariat and Executive Board of VH15, and all of us present here today are indeed honored to have amongst us our keynote speaker, Mr. Rohit Bansal. And I have visited for Delhi Public School, St. Stephen's College, University of Westminster, and Harvard Business School. Mr. Rohit Bansal is a versatile man who has donned many impressive hats. Currently, he is the CEO of India Strategy Group, Hamar Rubai and Salomon Consulting, apart from which he is also an independent columnist and director. To his credit, he was the COO of Independent News Private Limited, which owns India TV, resident editor at the Indian Express, senior business correspondent for the Times of India, and editor business and channel brand manager at Zee Telecoms and SL Group. Amongst his interests are wildlife and conservation, teaching tennis, playing squash, and basic golf. On behalf of the VH15 Secretariat and Ripyur High, I now request Mr. Bansal to deliver the keynote address.
I must say that when I saw the pictures of Ripyur 1, I thought this might have happened 5 weeks back, not 5 years back, because Principal Shin looks exactly the same after 5 years. So, thank you very much. I feel very welcomed and also a little daunted by the task, because my own claim to fame to the United Nations is almost non-existent, except that as a business editor of Zee several years back when Priyanka's political adversaries, the BJP, were in power. Prime Minister Vajpayee took me to United Nations when he delivered the annual thing which all prime ministers do in September. And I decided that let me try and go and see somebody in United Nations. And lo and behold, there was Shashi Tharoor, who is closer to Priyanka than he is to Vajpayee. So he was the Under Secretary General and a senior of mine in St. Stephen's, so he was very kind to see me. And that's when I was on the 36th floor and trying to figure out, and there was the United Nations, the Peace Prize that United Nations had got. So it was hanging on Shashi's backdrop, and it was rather interesting to sit and talk. And lo and behold, when he dropped me to the lift, who was standing there, someone, the principal quoted Kofi Annan. So I got my 2 seconds of fame with Kofi Annan as well. There was no time and age for selfies at that time. So if you ask me for proof, I have none. But you have to take my word for it. And I think that's the wafer thin, I think, logic of probably inviting me here. You know far more about the United Nations system, except to tell you my own little bit that I think India made a huge mistake in fielding a Secretary General candidate a few years back. It was without any homework. It was without the congruence of the United States of America, which, you know, hosts the United Nations. So we had a very, ill-conceived bid. And lo and behold, Shashi Tharoor, my senior from college, lost with a very convincing margin. And Ban Ki-moon is here. It's good that MUN and MON actually kind of rhyme. So it's okay. This is defeat is part of the learning. And I think India will now make a bid at some point of time for a more planned assault at the top job. But Ban Ki-moon is a friend of India. He has all the good things to say about us. And generally, I think he has proved to be a great choice for India. Now, why are you doing this is something that strikes me as a great training for your future. ladies and gentlemen. I wouldn't say boys and girls because that reminds me of Indigo Airlines. They always say this for some reason in their announcements. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think the critical issues which you will absorb here would be far more apparent to you than they could be to me, because I've just been talking about this and thinking about it for a few hours and days, and you have planned and prepared this, I was assured, for almost a year. So you would know far more than I could. But just to give you some recurrent themes which might help you in your further validation of the exercise, the excellent work that has gone on. My sense is that, A, as the principal said, you are actually in a networked world. So probably it's a good idea that you appreciate certain broad currents and then plan how you want to benefit from this. One broad current is Facebook. Facebook is the third largest country on the planet in by way of membership or citizenship, if you will. So there is China, there is India, and Facebook is just about trying to cross the number of members that it has, vis-a-vis the citizens India has. So if you embrace this as a fact, and you embrace network effects that kick in, because if you set up another Facebook, it will be a long time before you catch up. So conceptually, you can use in your networking or your power or your collaborative action Facebook as a good opportunity. So all of you have presumably Facebook pages. Can I have a show of hands as to who has Facebook pages? That's all? That's all? Okay. Almost 70%. So 30% of you are still following what Google says. Facebook is the ultimate time waster on the planet. That's what they say. But for those of you who are 70% or those of you who are still not there, critical issue is that as CEOs of your life, which you are, so whether you are a student or whether you are a manager or you are a president of a company or an owner, you are always the CEO of your life, and you will die the CEO of your life just as you were born the CEO of your life. So in that context, if you have to increase the value which you bring on the table, not merely for yourself, but to leave a better planet, to add a social contract to your entire promise, Facebook is a good ally to have conceptually, because 1 billion people are already there. So if you can have something worthwhile to communicate to them, it could be a good ally for your thinking process, including being here and how you go back together a little more connected than just meeting over a sandwich. So try and set up the relevant hashtag which allows you to connect with each other a little more than your personal association with the Facebook page. While talking on social networking, I think Twitter is a very strong medium to also bring out people who are not just your friends, but those who you address in your work, in your education, in your growth story as a CEO of your life. So try and embrace Twitter early. Is there a show of hands possible on who is on Twitter? Okay. So a fewer set of people are on Twitter, as I see from this show of hands. And that's exactly the situation in the world as well. So while there are 1 billion people on Facebook, about 300 million are on Twitter. And that seems to be the ratio here as well in contextual terms. The advantage of Twitter is that it makes you act very precisely, starts making you think shorter, and you don't even have the luxury of all the 140 characters, because that is the limit of Twitter. But if you ideally, as Priyanka would tell you, because she's a bit of a rock star on Twitter, unlike me, I have only 76 followers and she has 76,000. So, so it helps you kind of bring together your views in a more concise manner, use links which could be useful to a potential set of people you've never known. And to bring her on one last time, I promise, I learned about her through Twitter, and she kind of followed me, or I followed her, and thereafter we have had communication, and it brings me here. So it could be a very rudimentary example of how networking happens across social media platforms among like-minded people. So right now you are in a school, you think you'll always be together. for the rest of your life. But 5 years, 10 years later, you'll notice that some people have fallen off. They've gone busy, they've gone somewhere and all. But social media will allow you to keep together around what is my, some sort of concluding theme on the usage of this, that go beyond yourself. So it's not necessarily about becoming rich or growing a big company or to simply make plenty of money for shareholders. That nobody is interested in. I think what's really important is the societal value people think you've brought on the table. So think of societal value as a very important goal to use social networking and your own collective creativity. So in case, just as an example, you think that some problem larger than your own needs to be fixed. What could be that problem? I'll just open it up for a minute. What is it that you would want to do? Maybe Shreya, you want to say something? What would be a big problem, big enough problem that you think you want to solve in the world? Anything that comes to your mind would be probably the honest answer. So there's no right or wrong answer, but you mean work around the literacy issue, right? Any volunteers? Yeah. Hunger. Right. So I'll just go with these two examples that they've been said about bringing down the literacy, gap that we have in India or in the world potentially, and the hunger gap. They more or less are a lifetime agenda. And if you build a business around it, and business is not a dirty word, business is a very positive outcome which allows you to have certain surpluses which you invest back into the problem. So Michael Porter at Harvard has worked a little bit on ensuring that companies don't just do charity, companies don't just make profits, but in the middle they generate social capital which gets employed back. So any company, I mean, Nestle is a bad example these days, but he's worked with Nestle to say that in Moga, where you have their milk, what is it that you do to the milkmen around? How do you conserve the value chain and ensure they get productivity and capital directly into their homes rather than through middlemen? A man called Varghese Kurien did it famously for NDDB and Amul, that he could, you know, electrify the whole ecosystem around Anand and then across Gujarat. So 4 o'clock bugle in the morning would be something where the whole village would light up and go quickly running with the milk and everything to the value chain and the cold chain which Varghese Kurien was able to found. So today we have the power of connectivity in a manner that is much beyond Kurien's time, perhaps even beyond what Michael Porter can think, because some of us are a little old. We don't necessarily embrace these technologies very well. We are still a little reticent about them. But you people have definitely the ability to think through these bigger problems than just the issue of bread and butter, and none of these are issues for you. So find a large enough social problem. Try and find a business model that is relevant to it. You are most welcome to catch hold of me on Twitter and to ask any things which come to you at some point of time, so we could even stay engaged on anything which intrigued you or you disagree with. But I think it's a very good exercise that I see here. Build a responsible business. Otherwise, if you plan to only work for somebody, that somebody, by the way, pays you only to keep you away from your business idea. So try and think of building your own companies, employ people who are challenged by a larger goal, try and add delivery into India. India is going to face a very interesting situation where that's my 2 pennies worth of promotion for Reliance. We are going to do a Reliance Jio. How many of you have heard of Jio? 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 Okay, very few. We plan to connect about 1 billion people together in the next 6 to 8 months. It will be the fastest highway of on the internet mobility platforms, and you will be able to, you know, do WhatsApp at 40 times the speed. You'll be able to get, you know, PDF files. You'll be able to video chat at a fraction of the cost that you might incur today, or your parents incur today on your phones. And it's not just fun and games. It's a lot of positive stuff you can do to link people in the area of literacy, in the area of rural transformation, in the area of banking. So many people in your homes would be working at the Sahayak level. They don't necessarily have bank accounts. They